This is one of the most secretive government sites in Britain. Throughout its 88-year history, it's tried to remain in the shadows. But this year, the Chemical and Biological Weapons Research Centre at Porton Down in Wiltshire was thrust into the spotlight by the inquest into the death of Ronald Madison. The 20-year-old National Serviceman died in 1953 after being tested with the nerve gas sarin. Fellow veterans of the test say many suffered the consequences of being human guinea pigs.
Madison died on the spot. I know of one widow that's a member of our group. Her husband died within a year of leaving there. I think he was 26. And there have been many premature deaths, people before the age of 60.
Ronald Madison was misled into volunteering to be tested within the confines of Porton Down. Tonight we reveal how parts of the southwest were used as a vast testing ground for biological and chemical warfare experiments. The public were unaware they were human guinea pigs in a desperate race to counter the threat of germ warfare during the Cold War.
The three-stage sampler was used to measure the dose and the viability of the test organism in the cloud.
They were actually contaminating this area with bacteria. Now, this amazed me. I thought that they were doing research work. It turned out that, no, they were using the area as a giant laboratory.
It doesn't surprise me when you consider the political culture of the time, because it was a culture of paternalism where the state knew best, that the people of the country were not entitled to know what was happening. Any actual pokings around in the workings of the state was considered unacceptable. And of course, the standard phrase that was used here was national security.
Porton Down was set up in 1916 to develop chemical weapons and to protect the British military from the effects of such ghastly means of conducting warfare. In the 50s and 60s, fears of a Soviet attack prompted a frenzy of secret scientific trials. Documents now declassified in the National Archives reveal that the public was sprayed with chemical compounds and bacteria throughout the West Country. Sprayings took place from the air, sea, and on land. The public knew nothing about these trials. As information about the clandestine activities of government scientists emerged, campaigners like Mike Kenner from Weymouth became curious.
When you find out you've been sprayed, you want to find out, what have I been sprayed with? Is it safe? Did anybody conduct toxicity tests on it? And this is the reason why I got into my sort of research I was doing. So I started asking questions of Porton Down, because I knew how to ask questions from Porton Down. John Major brought in this code of practice, 1994, which made it more possible for the public to be able to ask these sort of questions.
The quarry village of Westwood near Bradford-on-Avon. During the Second World War, these old mines were transformed into a hive of underground activity. Hundreds of people were relocated from the Midlands to work in a bomb-proof Royal Enfield factory. The wartime work was secretive, but what workers didn't know was that next door to them was even more sensitive government property. Underground tunnels were used to store priceless art treasures from the British Museum, whilst German bombers blitzed London. Works of art from Buckingham Palace were relocated and carefully stored in air-conditioned rooms. When the war ended, the pieces were moved out, but the government held on to the site. Scientists from Porton Down thought it was the perfect place to conduct their experiments, as this exclusive footage shows.
Technicians working in the test chamber during trial changed completely into protective clothing. This was not so much for safety as to avoid carrying heavy contamination into the lab area nearby, where the samples were handled.
During the 50s, there was concern that Britain's underground and transport system could be vulnerable to being sabotaged by terrorists, releasing toxic substances into ventilation systems. Scientists wanted to see if an attack was viable, so used a bacteria to simulate a more deadly biological agent.
The experiment involved the release of a bacteria which had been developed in America for the same purpose, as a simulant for anthrax. It's spores from the same size as anthrax spores, and it behaved in the same manner. It was supposed to be absolutely harmless. It was supposed to be a harmless simulant, but in fact, later research proved that in certain cases it wasn't as harmless as they'd first hoped.
For 50 years, these documents remained under lock and key. They reveal that even the man in charge of the trials was not convinced that one of the bacteria used, Serratia marcescens or SM, was totally harmless.
Wing Commander Mackay, who conducted these trials for Porton Down at the Westwood Quarry, was very concerned about the levels of SM that the workers outside the chamber were exposed to, and he called it a so-called pathogen. Which shows that even in those days, we're talking the 1950s, a Porton Down scientist was very worried as to whether this bacteria could cause disease or not.
A Porton Down spokesman says at the time SM was internationally recognised as a non-pathogen. It was checked by animal tests, but Porton says they do not have any details of what this entailed. The bacteria has since been described as an opportunistic pathogen. This means those with a low immune system could be vulnerable if exposed to the bacteria. Graham Myatt spent 6 years working underground for the Royal Enfield factory during the 1950s. He started as an apprentice and was involved in high-precision engineering work. He remembers the secrecy surrounding what he was making, but had no idea about what was going on in the old British Museum site next door. Bob Tonkis started working underground in 1945 as an apprentice toolmaker. Apart from a break for national service, he remained there until 1963.
But they couldn't stress it enough that you had to keep away from the place. Nobody was allowed near it.
We showed Graham and Bob footage obtained from the Imperial War Museum of the government experiment at Westwood. Bob was working underground at the time of the SM trials, so would have been exposed to the bacteria. The factory and the old museum site shared the same air conditioning and ventilation system.
It seems so underhand and terrible that people are subjected to this. I mean, if it was a foreign country, we would be jumping up and down and saying how terrible, but it's happened here.
But I think now we were misled. This is why.
Porton don't seem to have been bothered about the workers next door. There's no mention of them in the trials document whatsoever. The statement in the trials document is ambiguous. We don't know whether he meant other Porton workers that were there or whether he meant the workers from the factory.
The most important thing is the fact that these experiments were carried out and they affected the public. They affected the public were used as guinea pigs for these experiments. And obviously the government didn't want that information to get out.
Not only the underground factory workers who would have inhaled the bacteria. Residents of Westwood, especially those living near the ventilation shafts, would have been exposed as well.
The people who lived in the houses, the people who worked underground here and lived on the surface, they would have been affected. There were some 600 families, I think, lived in close proximity to the ventilation shafts.
Porton Down scientists didn't want to be interviewed, but said in a statement they are not aware of any use of SM in outdoor trials since 1979. Mike Kenner has spent years researching how the public was exposed to simulated germ warfare. The railway coach trials were classified top secret for 50 years. To this day, few people know that part of the rail network in Dorset was used for experiments. The aim was to simulate a biological attack on a train travelling from Salisbury to Exeter. The tests were conducted on a separate railway coach and also from inside a tunnel near Gillingham. Again, the bacteria were designed to mimic anthrax spores.
A man stood inside Buckhorn Western Tunnel. He had a man pack on. He waited for the train to come in. It was an old steam train. He had to try and wait, judge his moment just right, and sprayed the train. Now, this was a regular train. There were ordinary people on this train. They would have got sprayed with the bacteria as well.
And the big concern there was with sabotage, that somebody would sneak onto a train, sneak into the London Underground, and commit an act of sabotage. And these are pervasive fears with biological warfare. They go right back to the 1930s when the evidence was gathered that German spies were trying out the London Underground and the Paris Metro for a German warfare attack.
The railway trials showed that it was feasible to attack passengers by disseminating germs, and demonstrated that Britain's transport system, both above and below ground, was vulnerable to biological attack. The political climate in the 50s was characterised by Cold War paranoia.
You had government bureaucracies that were trying to plan for all eventualities, the worst case scenarios that they could possibly think of, be it nuclear war, biological, chemical war, invasion, internal subversion. And these bureaucracies, they would plan for these situations, they would work out responses to those situations, and they would try and anticipate what those in power might want to ask them, but might fear was too politically sensitive to ask them.
In part two, we show how this area of Dorset was sprayed with bacteria under cover of darkness. In the 1950s, fears of a biological warfare attack were focused on buildings and transport systems. In the 60s, the government grew alarmed at the possible threat of entire cities being sprayed with toxic agents. This prompted Porton Down scientists to conduct a series of trials using fluorescent particles of zinc cadmium sulphide, or FP. Although Britain stopped developing its own biological weapons in the mid-50s, documents now declassified show scientists were still discussing the need to defend against an attack. The Ministry of Defence says the trials had to be secret to avoid alerting the enemy, in this case the Soviet Union.
People started to think much more in terms of what's called an off-target attack. In other words, someone would come along, fly a plane or sail a ship, say 200 miles along the English Channel, and slowly release a cloud of biological agents, and this huge cloud would drift across a whole region and poison them. As this idea took hold during the late 1950s, the scientists started to say, well, we've got to do experiments to see whether or not this is a real threat or not. And that's why they were concerned about the potential of the large area coverage and the large area threat.
According to these documents, there was no option but to keep these trials secret, despite some openness in the US about similar trials in the early 1960s. In August 1960, Salisbury and its surrounding area was sprayed with particles of zinc cadmium sulphide, a chemical which mimicked toxic agents.
So a plane flew about 40 miles away from Salisbury, and for 100 miles, it flew in an arc, for 100 miles it was spraying this zinc cadmium sulphide particles, spraying about £1 per mile, so £100 in all was used. All across Salisbury, there was a sampling grid set up. There were two grids set up. One was rural, one was in the centre of the city. And they'd both be monitoring the air. At every one of these stations, air monitoring was taking place. And if it had used biological warfare agents, you can see what they were practicing. It would have wiped out the entire city.
Cadmium is a known carcinogen. These trials were done without any toxicology tests being carried out. Normally, when Porton scientists use a simulant for tests, they gave it a T number. This substance had no such number. Even Porton's own official biographer mentions in an internal review how surprising it was that no tests were done before or after the spraying. He concludes there are no reports on toxicity.
They really thought that this was stable. They thought that it wasn't going to cause any harm to anybody and proceeded on that basis. They just assumed that it would be safe.
I don't think they deny that the substance itself is toxic, because they made sure that all their workers wore appropriate protective equipment while using the stuff. They all wore dust masks with home office respirator kits. They all made sure that they wore surgeon's caps, surgeon's gloves and overalls, and that the overalls were washed in a special laundry. And the building that the zinc cadmium sulphide was stored in was demolished by burning. It was incinerated.
Due to public unease, an independent scientist, Professor Peter Lackman, was asked to conduct a review of the use of zinc cadmium sulphide. But as no official report was produced on the spraying of Salisbury, this was not included in the inquiry. A spokesman for Porton says while some cadmium compounds are undoubtedly toxic, FP is not. It says the Lackman report points out that the available evidence indicates there was no danger to health.
No one knows what happened in Salisbury. They're blissfully unaware. The reason being is that if Porton did an experiment and they didn't like the trial's results, or they felt that they weren't very good results, they weren't, you know, didn't give what they were looking for, they didn't write up a report. If they didn't write up a report, then that never goes into the public record office. It wasn't given to the independent review. So the residents of Salisbury have no idea that these two trials took place in August of 1960.
Although BW appears easy, defence is difficult. How can an attack be detected quickly? You can't smell it. You can't see it. You can't taste it. You can't feel it. And you can't hear it. Our atmosphere is heavily polluted with all kinds of small particles, so the detection of a disease-causing particle is a complex problem. If costly research produces a detection method, should we make our knowledge public and hence easier for an aggressor to avoid?
The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
Back in 1963, Porton planned a series of tests over a large area off the south coast, known as the Dorset Defence Trials. The scientists wanted to see if bacteria which mimicked biological agents sprayed at sea retained harmful effects when drifting inland. Most trials contain E.coli and a bacteria called Bacillus globigii, which occurs naturally in hay and soil. The E.coli, a different strain to the one which causes food poisoning, was isolated from feces on a toilet seat at Porton Down and cultured in the laboratories.
The ICEWHALE was actually used to spray these organisms, and then there was detectors at various points, both on the coast and inland, and these tried to pick up how many of the organisms both landed and how many of them survived, to see how far this cloud would spread.
Now, the reason why they came to Lyme Bay is it's a semicircular bay, which means that they can use all sorts of wind directions. So they could put a ship in there. It could sail in a straight line course, spraying bacteria out the back out of an adapted agricultural sprayer. These bacteria were carried onshore and sampled inland by mobile teams.
These trials were done in utmost secrecy. They were done at night, not so much for secrecy, but because the organisms survived better at night, but that added a layer of secrecy. Then on top of that, people were just not told about these experiments. In fact, the documents about the experiments only came to light in around 1997-1998, so they were kept under wraps for a very long period of time.
Whilst these trials were designed for specific research purposes, they demonstrated in a striking way the feasibility of small-scale biological warfare. An appreciable dose of viable bacteria was achieved over an area greater than 1,000 square miles by the release of only 120 gallons of suspension.
Weymouth, Portland, all of the South Dorset area is pretty unique insofar as that we have had over 80 germ warfare attacks, although that they didn't use pathogens to intentionally cause illness. We have been attacked. All the methods that were used would be used in a germ warfare attack.
Between 1963 and 68, 36 separate bacteria experiments were done in Lyme Bay from the ship ICEWHALE. When the secret documents were released 7 years ago, there was such an outcry that an independent review of the possible health hazards was commissioned. The bacterial simulants used in the trials were analysed to see if the population had been put at risk.
E. coli traced with BG means just a mixture of E. coli and Bacillus globigii. And the reason that those two bacteria were used were, first of all, Bacillus globigii forms very, very stable, tough spores. and that is used to simulate the behaviour of anthrax, Bacillus anthracis, the anthrax bacterium. Anthrax is, of course, a very well-known germ warfare agent, and it is very, very stable, very tough, survives. Whereas E. coli is a much more delicate organism and is more typical of most of the other bacteria that might be used as germ warfare agents, like, for example, plague.
Professor Spratt concluded that the overwhelming majority of people in Dorset are likely to have suffered health problems. But those who are susceptible to disease, for example, people with chest infections, may have been more at risk. He could find no link with clusters of birth defects, miscarriages and learning disabilities found at nearby East Lulworth. A Porton spokesman says as the threat is very different now from 50 years ago, they can foresee no future need for such studies. After decades of secrecy, mystery still surrounds exactly who authorised these tests in populated areas. Porton's own field trials document admits there's a paucity of information, and in many instances authority for these tests came only from within Porton. This memo, written by the chief scientist in 1963, admits if the trials were made public, it would be politically embarrassing. The matter of authority is, according to declassified documents, now almost impossible to trace.
It's very interesting that they were able to write in these documents that this had better not get out because it will be politically embarrassing. That shows that they did not expect those documents to be read, whereas now those in government are much more canny about the probability of documents being read and are much more cautious about how they operate.
In the next programme, how sprayings over public areas continued into the 70s. And as the threat of bioterrorism rears its head again, we reveal exclusive details of further anthrax tests.
Well, what worries me is that we're starting to repeat experiments that were done 50 years ago. We're going in a circle yet again.